Well, it's Friday, so you know what that means. It's Tuesdays with Corey. Hello, Corey Brettschneider, professor.
Hello, David. I still like that joke. Doesn't get old. I'm going to get funnier with time. Age as well.
I'm an originalist. I think we should...
That's good.
Something worked 200 years ago. I keep telling the same joke. I'm going to give your credentials because it's enlightening. It involves gobbledygook, or whatever Justice Roberts called it. You have an undergraduate degree from Pomona. You have a master's in philosophy from Cambridge. You have a law degree from Stanford. You have a PhD in political science from Princeton. You're very informed. And today we're going to talk about a lot of things. But one of the things I want to discuss with you is a study that came out of ProPublica this week about how ill-informed the Supreme Court is, how they do not have a research service, that a lot of the amicus briefs that come their way, which are supposed to bolster people's sides before the Supreme Court with stats and information, a lot of these amicus briefs are erroneous, and that the Supreme Court is not dealing with facts, so that when we talked about that gerrymandering case before the Supreme Court about Wisconsin, there's a gerrymandering case about whether or not Wisconsin is dividing the districts up fairly. Roberts kind of intimated that they're not equipped to review the math, that they don't really understand it.
Yeah, I mean, I think sometimes the Supreme Court and legal argument can include, you know, look, the question is evidence. And so if there's statistics that point in a particular direction, that's certainly relevant, can be relevant to a factual finding. And in this case, whether or not the fact of whether or not there's statistical proof that there's Republicans or Democrats that are engaged in gerrymandering or moving the legislative and congressional maps in a way that advantage them, you know, some of the evidence is statistical. So, yeah, yet Roberts kind of tried to do this aw shucks thing, which suggests I'm too naive to know how to make sense of this stuff. And I don't know, I think it frustrates a lot of people who think that's your job as a justice, is to weigh the evidence. And if there's good evidence that requires you to do some math or to learn a little bit about, you know, statistics, then, you know, that's the job. Do it. Don't just use this word and throw up your hands.
Are they equipped to do that kind of research?
Well, I mean, I guess that's the point of John Pfaff's article today in the New York Times in the op-ed section, is that they hire clerks all the time to help them with evidence and to help them with research. And why would there not be, in the same way that there's a Congressional Budget Office or offices within the executive branch that are able to weigh evidence and to do statistical analysis, it seems like it might be a good idea for the country to invest in a research arm for the Supreme Court that could just help them to make sense of the statistical evidence. In the end, you know, the job of the justice is to weigh the evidence and to give a legal ruling, but they might get help from researchers who know something about the basics of statistics. Throwing up your hands at it, I guess that seems like a bad solution.
Which is kind of what Chief Justice Roberts said during the hearings. He said, I'm worried this is just going to be sociological gobbledygook. And
yeah, I think what he said was that, you know, it might, I mean, it's kind of worse, because I think what he's saying is it might make perfect sense and it might be great evidence. But to me, you know, this is what I meant by the aw shucks sort of attitude. I'm just a, you know, lawyer from, I don't know where he's from, but from wherever. And I can't make sense of it because I don't have a PhD in statistics. And the reason I say it's worse is because he's admitting it might be good evidence, but that he just doesn't have the ability to look into it. He has the ability. It's, you know, really a question of will.
And time. And they're saying that when Justice Roberts overturned provisions of the Voting Rights Act, we're no longer monitoring the old Confederacy and making sure that African Americans are allowed to vote. There was a Supreme Court decision 4 years ago that said everybody's, is it Shelby County? Is that the Supreme Court?
Yes, that's the case. Yeah. Did he make a similar statement there about gobbledygook? Or
well, no, no, no. What they're saying in the ProPublica report is that when Justice Roberts overturned provisions in the Voting Rights Act, and these counties from the old Confederacy are no longer being observed by the Supreme Court because Justice Roberts said black people can vote. They don't have a problem anymore, that he was working off faulty information.
I have to think about that. And I've read John Pfaff's editorial. I haven't read the ProPublica piece, so I have to look, but it could be. I mean, from my memory from that case, a lot of the argument was about whether or not Congress in its role had succeeded in updating the formula that they use to figure out which districts are subject to being covered and not covered by the Voting Rights Act. And there was a sort of complaint actually in the case that Congress hadn't really been doing its job in, I guess, which it would include statistical analysis and looking at ongoing discrimination or rectification of discriminatory practices. That was at least part of the account. So to me there, what he's doing is acknowledging that statistics are important. It might give you an insight into his view, which is something like, well, that's Congress that's supposed to do that stuff, and we're not equipped to do it. But why the court couldn't equip itself, I don't know. I mean, that was the point of Fast article today, that they could create this research arm. I mean, really, you know, it's amazing how little staff they have. I mean, they have themselves, they have the clerks, they have, you know, some other staff, but it is nothing compared to the staff, certainly of the executive branch, which is over 2.5 million, or to Congress, which also is probably understaffed, but has this budget office and has a research arm that can do some of this analysis. And, you know, why the court in its increasingly complicated role of looking at data wouldn't have this as well is a great question. And, you know, it's just a question of will, I think.
I guess they feel that the law clerk should spend all their time poring over precedent.
Well, you know, the law clerks, it's a really fascinating issue. There's debate, I guess, about how much influence. They're clearly partially influential because they're the main staff of the justices. They're recent graduates of law schools, and they're in their usually mid-20s. And, you know, what's their training? It's that they've been to 3 years of law school. In some cases, they might have a social science background as undergrads. I don't know how many have had PhDs, but my guess is very few. And, you know, they are equipped to look at precedent, read the prior cases. In some cases, maybe to do some historical research, they might be asked by some of the justices who are inclined that way. But they're not equipped to do what Pfaff is talking about, which is the independent research that would be required to, you know, really have the knowledge that would be required to assess the arguments that come in these amicus briefs or in the briefs of the litigants.
And the other possibility is that you have these 70-year-old, 80-year-old Supreme Court justices who are going to be ruling on cybersecurity and Facebook. And do they even know what Facebook is?
I hope so. I don't know if any of them are on it. We could check it. We could try to friend. It'd be fun to try to friend Justice Roberts and Justice Thomas. I don't know. I mean, I think that's why, you know, they know these things partly from their clerks, who certainly are on Facebook and know what these technologies are. But some of what they need to know goes beyond the knowledge of a 25-year-old. You know, you got to be pretty brilliant, basically, to get this job. It's top of the class, often from the top law schools. And, you know, I'm sure they are, on the whole, brilliant kids, but they're in their mid-20s. And there should be a professional staff as well of people who know how to do data analysis. And, you know, it wouldn't be that expensive. And I think having some sort of permanent advisors like that would be a good thing for the court, given the difficulty of the modern problems they're facing.
Speaking of Facebook, let's talk about our Facebook page. There is one now where people can sign up and get the latest assignments and share articles. And you're keeping it alive, and I thank you for that. I'm keeping it alive by typing in the word HUDNUT. Jeffrey.
Yeah, I saw that. As you said, you're the kid in the back of the class. Just keeps whispering it, distracting the teacher every time.
I'm making paper airplanes and just saying HUDNUT. So people.
What's really difficult as the professor, I guess, in this role is that you just want to laugh, but then it'll distract in the details of the case and a lack of seriousness of the David Feldman show that it's really just going to descend into a comedy podcast.
So what is the name of the Facebook page? Do we have to invite people or can they just sign up? How do they do this?
Well, now we're criticizing the justice system for not knowing Facebook. I think we're really showing.
How does the social
now Facebook?
How does the social media gobbledygook work?
This is just gobbledygook. I think if they type in to the search bar Tuesdays with Corey, you can make a request. The group will come up and we'll get the request and we can approve it. They could also just, if you they want to friend me, Corey Brettschneider, on Facebook, I could do that and then I'll send the invite that way, or they could do the same with you.
Right. Now, with me, I should point out, in order to be approved, there's a $50 processing fee.
Oh, wow.
With Corey,
what do
I don't
know. I get a cut of that, right?
I don't know what you're charging, but in order to review, it takes time.
Wow.
We take into account geographical distribution and what kind of family you come from, what kind of income, public school, private school. We're looking for diversity. SAT scores, and there's an essay.
Wow, I didn't know you could do that. An essay.
You have to write an essay.
Like really getting into, you do have to take the SAT, or is that optional?
The SATs are required, but more importantly, it's an essay.
You want to be friends?
Why you want to be friends, and just why you think David Feldman is so entertaining.
Okay, that's fair. It's just like getting into college. Why do you want to attend Princeton? You accept the ACT? Do you know about that? You don't want to be regionally biased. A lot of people from the Midwest take that.
And you also need a recommendation from...
Does it have to be a licensed comedy writer?
Comedy writer. And then an interview. You have to sit down with an alumni. Or is it alumni or alumnus?
Alumnus, I think, is a singular.
A graduate of Tuesdays with Corey. Anyway...
We should give a certificate.
Then you got to see.
We need to do a public service announcement, by the way, because my uncle was confused. We had lunch yesterday. We had a lovely lunch. And my uncle Lane, who listens to every single one of these shows, wanted to know if I really am pursuing my comedy license and if that was a real thing. So I think you have to answer that question. That's a question from a devoted listener.
There used to be something called a cabaret license.
Oh.
And they took it away from Lenny Bruce in the 60s because he was too dirty. In order to get up on stage and perform comedy in New York, and I think this was also in San Francisco, you needed something called a cabaret license. And if you didn't have one, you could not tell jokes.
That's interesting. So you sort of had to promise to not be too funny.
Or you couldn't be dirty.
Well, right. And which sometimes means funny.
Yeah.
So did he sue? And it was revoked?
Well, I guess he was brought. I think they were going to lock him up for the cursing. I think they'll.
Wow.
Yeah. I think we should bring back the cabaret license, actually.
But you would do it merit-based or you would do it based on whether you're dirty or not?
I think you should know the Morse code before you can tell jokes. Do you know at the beginning of radio, you had to know the Morse code? I'm serious.
What, just in case, like, there was an emergency, or what? What was the
rationale? That was, in order to talk and have a license to be a radio personality, you had to know the Morse code. In fact, before you were born, I had a job in radio, and you had to do meter readings. You had to know how to read a meter.
But a lot of this stuff, I'm sure, I mean, it sounds like the Morse code thing is like this. Was just a way of capturing the industry, right? And limiting your competition and keeping people out. I mean, that's at least a lot of the criticism of not all licensing, but some of it is that it's just a way of kind of capturing the industry for the few who are in it already and keeping others out.
When you get your mani-pedi, you don't care if she's licensed or not?
Yeah, I mean, like I said, there are some industries where I guess it does make sense because there's a health concern. But what's the worry in the comedy world that somebody would be, what, not funny? Or, I mean, it seems like that's not something you'd want to regulate.
You should need a license to do comedy.
Huh. Where are you on Uber? I mean, I know the company has problems, not just Uber, but lift and get. And
right now, because things are tight, I've taken work with Uber. They have a new comedy service. I will come to your house through Uber and insult your family, make fun
you
of your kids.
You get to ride in the car? Like, I can order Uber comedy and then I ride in the car with you and you tell jokes?
No. It's they deliver food, Uber, and now they have Uber comedy, where I will come into your house. I'll ruin a party, eat all your food, tell you what's wrong with your life. Wait, pick up a little extra. I had an idea that
You should do that.
No, I had an idea for, this is disgusting, and then we'll get back to the show. I had an idea to have portisans hooked up to a car. What would happen is if you had to go to the bathroom, instead of using a public toilet, you order Uber toilet and... and we would.
I love that because I truly hate porta potties. So that idea of, and it would be.
And you and I, we would have like a
minimal.
We'd have a side business. We would drive a pickup truck that had on it like a really upscale toilet, and you'd go in. It would be clean. It would be tidy. Nobody else would be in there. So that if you have to go to the bathroom, instead of using, you know, a public restroom where anything can happen, you would go to the street. We drive up, you get in, you know.
I love it. You know, it's like, you know, there also with all these things, there are different levels. So there's like, you know, Uber X, Uber Black, Uber VIP. And so you could have that too for this. And of course, the highest level would be the gold.
Yeah.
Toilet, which Trump made famous, of course.
Yeah, we would have, the cheapest would be the pool. You wouldn't share it. They're just.
Pool would be that you have to share. That would be.
No, it's not sharing. It's just we don't clean it that much. So there's a little pool. All right.
I got to say, I'm not a fan of Uber. Have you ever taken Uber pool?
Yes, but I have a trick that then we're going to work. Okay. Because obviously I'm stalling and people complain. Here's the trick for singles.
This is like when you get the professor completely off track. Like, professor, can you tell us about whether you've seen the new Star Wars? Or?
So I haven't done this, but it did occur to me to do this. I had a meeting. Let's say I had a meeting. I don't remember where it was, but for all intents and purposes, let's say I was at the St. Regis Hotel, which is very nice, right?
Mm-hmm.
I ordered an Uber pool, right? Mm-hmm. And I get in, and there were these attractive professional women seeing me picked up in front of the St. Regis Hotel. And they thought I was successful. And in New York City, that's all you need to be attractive. If I were craven, which I'm not, one of the things I would do if I were a single guy desperately trying to meet women, I would put on a suit, order my Uber pool at the St. Regis, and then be taken to another prestigious address, like a brownstone on 68th.
I don't think it works that way. I think they could pick you up there, and then the next pickup could be anywhere.
Right, but if there are women already in the car seeing you picked up in front of a fancy hotel, they're going to think you're marriage material.
Well, I don't know. I'm not an expert in dating, but this just doesn't seem to me to be your best.
How about deception? How about?
Yeah, I think you want to start with honesty and just kind of, I don't know. Doesn't seem. Maybe. I'm not an expert. You can let me know.
Not that I would ever try that.
No. This is all hypothetical.
All right. The travel ban. Give us an update.
Good transition.
Thank you. Well, it's, you know, Uber, you travel.
The latest is that a judge in Hawaii has struck down what's now the third travel ban and ruled that it is still unconstitutional. And, you know, I think for good reason. We're going to submit our amicus brief again. And I think the argument is simple. This is the third iteration of a policy which Donald Trump has, from the beginning, told us is based in anti-Muslim animus. And he keeps changing it and tweaking it. And this time, I will admit, he's come up with a clever argument or a clever change to the policy, which is really a pretext for a legal argument, which is, of course, it's not based in anti-Muslim animus because we've now added North Korea and Venezuela to the list, and that's not, those are not countries that are predominantly Muslim. The problem, though, is it just looks to me, you could let me know what you think, like a pretty obvious pretext, and that I think judges and the laws are smarter than that and realize that just because you, you know, put a little, a friend of mine said, you know, it's like the Sarah Palin line, you can put lipstick on a pig, it's still a pig, and that's exactly what's going on here.
I've never put lipstick on a pig. High heels, some lingerie, but I draw a line at the lipstick.
If you're Donald Trump, you're doing whatever it takes. Somebody told me they have, you know, there's an office in the White House called the Office of Legal Counsel. It's sort of like the president's person that he goes to tell if a law is unconstitutional instead of, or a policy or an executive order. Instead of waiting for the litigation, the idea is you go to this internal office and their duty is to kind of give you advice internally. Now, I think for a long time that office was occupied by a holdover from the Obama administration. And I'm sure, I don't have any inside knowledge, but I'm sure that person was saying, don't do this about the travel ban, and they weren't listening. Well, now that office has been filled by a new person, and I'm not sure if this is the reason, but all of a sudden they have so far their best maneuver, which is this maneuver that they've just made, and maybe that's because their lawyers are getting better. So, you know, it's getting to be a harder battle here, but I still think in the end common sense should prevail, that this is the same policy with the same motivation.
And when does the Supreme Court make their decision?
Well, we just don't know. We're, you know, the Supreme Court, what happened in the last case is when he changed the policy, they canceled the oral argument and said basically that the case was moot, the old one that we were battling over, the what was then the second ban. And now this third ban has happened, and the
second ban expired, right?
Yes, it expired, and they basically now have this new policy, which they're right. claiming is completely new. So I think their argument is, the idea is it's irrelevant because there's now just a completely new policy. And so basically the litigation just begins again. You go to the lowest, instead of being at the Supreme Court, you go to the lowest court in the federal system, which is called the district court. And this district court has started to hear arguments all around the country, but the one in Hawaii has heard arguments about the constitutionality of this third ban. And now the second thing that will happen is that there'll be an appeal. The Trump administration is not going to accept the ruling, and it will likely go to the appellate court in that district, which is the in that area of the country, which is the Ninth Circuit Court. And then that court will render a decision. This will also happen throughout the country in other courts, likely, as they rule to stop the ban and then appeal. And eventually the Supreme Court, I think, will have to hear it. And what the timeline is I'm not sure. I mean, that's going to be up to them, but maybe even within a few months.
Trump's legacy could last for 40 years because he's going to be pretty successful in filling the federal judiciary with lots of crackpots. A lot of Judge Roy Moores, right?
Unfortunately, I think that they're right. He is filling a lot of vacancies, and that, you know, these federal judges, you know, are there way, way longer than he will be. And yes, unfortunately, my one caveat, I guess, is, you know, Ray Moore is really out there. I mean, my professional judgment is he is a constitutional lunatic. His views are so profoundly at odds with any mainstream understanding of the Constitution that it's beyond the pale. So I don't think that the appointments that Trump is going to make are anything like that. It's people I disagree with. I think Justice Gorsuch has turned out to be just as bad as I predicted, unfortunately. But Ray Moore is a totally different kind of figure, you know, now Senate candidate, really beyond the pale. So yes, they'll be bad, but not that bad.
Well, there have been a couple that I read about.
I think I can't remember how I pronounced it, but it's Ray Moore, right?
Roy Moore.
Well, that's my professional judgment.
Some of these judges that Trump is going to be appointing have written on their blog some pretty insane things about gun rights and overthrowing the government and some stuff about homosexuals that are pretty shocking.
I was going to say, what makes Moore to me just completely, I don't know, there are many things, but you know, this sort of, first of all, he my understanding is that he's given credence to the idea that there's, you know, Sharia law that's a threat to the United States, despite no evidence that anything like that is happening. And at the same time that he worries about Sharia law, he is a theocrat. I mean, mm-hmm. this sort of stand about the Ten Commandments is not just that one symbol, but that he doesn't seem to believe at all in the guarantee against the establishment of an official religion in the United States. And to the contrary, all of his positions seem to support the idea that the United States should try to basically take a certain version of Christianity that he subscribes to and impose it on other people. And to me, that's the definition of theocracy. So at the same time that he's famous for objecting to a potential Muslim theocracy through what he calls Sharia law, a threat that is nowhere to be found in the United States, he advocates his own form of theocracy. And,
right.
you know, that to me is, that's what's beyond the pale. The First Amendment, if the Constitution means anything, it's that it prohibits the endorsement of a religion as true and making law based on one particular religion. And that's, you know, what he's all about.
The Establishment Clause.
That is the meaning, right, as we've discussed often, the Establishment Clause, or the prohibition on respecting an establishment of religion, prohibits the country from making law based on Christianity or any other kind of religion. And anyone who campaigns, and certainly a judge who claims to know law, on the basis that America is a kind of Christian republic, is fundamentally at odds with the meaning of our Constitution.
I heard a rumor that before your book was entitled When the State Speaks,
mm-hmm.
it was originally going to be called Yes, Virginia, There Is an Establishment Clause.
I like that. That'll be my next one. Co-author.
Yeah, my mother's not getting any younger. To put my name
on... You could put the HUDNUT in there.
Put my name on the...
I have a lot of HUDNUT.
Put my name on the amicus brief, please.
We're back to that?
Yeah. After all I've done for you. I don't know what I've done for you, but...
Who does the Emmy Award?